Last time, we saw that in order to build a Hamiltonian that is relativistic and only needs one time derivative, we had to switch to matrices. This means, unlike the Schrödinger equation, the Dirac equation is a matrix equation where some matrices act on a column vector. We called these matrices in the Hamiltonian alpha and beta, and in order to arrive at the relativistic energy-momentum relation, we found some constraints on alpha and beta. In special relativity, it's super useful to use the four notation, that is, writing down our math using four vectors. That's what we'll do today. This is our Dirac equation. We multiply by beta from the left and denote the momentum by a spatial derivative. Next, we move all our terms to the left side of the equation, such that we have some terms that equal zero. Now we define a gamma zero to replace beta and some gamma k to replace beta times alpha k. As usual in special relativity, we collect a temporal index and three spatial indices into one Minkowski index, mu. So we can write the Dirac equation as I gamma mu d mu minus m acting on psi equals zero. It's useful to know how these new gamma matrices are related to each other. The alphas and betas had equations using anti-commutators. So let's put the gamma matrices into anti-commutators as well. For gamma zero with gamma zero, this is easy to do. For gamma zero with gamma k, we use the anti-commutator relation between alpha and beta. And for gamma k with gamma j, we first use the anti-commutator relation between alpha and beta to switch out two pairs of alphas and betas while picking up a minus sign. Then we can use the anti-commutator of two alphas to get to our result. Finally, we can collect our three anti-commutators into one equation like this using the Minkowski metric eta. That's pretty much it for this time. Thanks for watching and see you next week.